Hello, this is Dr. Rybinnik. Today we will talk about how design matters, especially when using Slideware in medical education. This video is rated MS for medical students due to basic concepts, clear language, and case-based examples. Medical student participation is advised. I have no relevant financial conflicts to disclose. This talk will serve three purposes: part inspiration, part practical advice, and part preservation of sanity. I have this selfish need to avoid being tortured by badly designed PowerPoints in the future. During the January 2003 spaceflight of the Shuttle Columbia, 82 seconds after liftoff, a nearly 2-pound piece of foam insulation broke off from the liquid fuel tank and hit the left wing. To help the NASA officials assess the threat, Boeing Corporation engineers prepared several PowerPoint presentations. This is an example slide from one of the Boeing presentations. The slide is dense and basically filled to the brim with speaker notes, separated by bullet points. The following analysis is courtesy of Edward Tufte, a professor emeritus of political science, statistics, and computer science at Yale University. He is a pioneer in the field of data visualization and an avid PowerPoint critic. Instinctively, we perceive bullet points as lists, which imply top-to-bottom hierarchy. So when the title at the top mentions conservatism with respect to concerns, and the third sentence states that the chances of penetration by debris were overpredicted, NASA officials were convinced that the report indicated that there was no problem, instead of significant uncertainty, and decided that the Shuttle Columbia was safe for atmospheric re-entry. It's not until you get to the bottom of the slide that you see words like "can cause significant damage" and "flight condition is significantly outside of test database." After orbiting for 2 weeks with an undetected hole in its wing, the Shuttle Columbia burnt up on re-entry. The presentation certainly cannot take all the blame, but this is an extreme example where slides at best misled and at worst harmed decision-making. Then why do we keep using Slideware like PowerPoint when teaching the sciences? Well, nearly 60 years of cognitive research tells us that people remember only 10% of what they read, 20% of what they hear — turns out we're social creatures who like stories — 30% of what they see, and 50% of what they see and hear. As the learning becomes more active, people remember 70% of what they say, and most of what they say and do. In medicine, time is constrained, and as you know, the amount of material is vast, so it's not really feasible to learn everything actively. But if we have to resort to passive learning, we want to maximize it whenever possible. So in this case, you see my slides, you hear me talk, and hopefully the two complement each other to improve learning. So say you're making a talk about the diagnosis of coma, like a certain talk you might find on this channel. Wink, wink. Creating a talk typically involves identifying the relevant content and then designing the slides. Content, of course, is extremely important. But so is design. Cognitive research tells us that slide design matters. I should really say that with more gusto. Design matters! Why? Have you heard of the cognitive load theory? This theory, in its present form, has been around for over 4 decades and has quite a bit of evidence behind it. The gist of the theory is that our working memory is finite. Working memory can only process a limited amount of new information at a time. Visual processing is generally higher bandwidth because it is synchronous. Multiple bits of visual data are processed simultaneously inside of our brain's so-called visuospatial sketchpad. We can take in more through our eyes before being overloaded. Auditory processing is more sequential. One thing, then the next, then the next. Where was I? Oh yeah, auditory processing. This sequential processing of auditory information is called the auditory loop. So we get tired of listening to information quicker than we do of viewing it. Unlike the limited working memory, our long-term memory seems to have infinite capacity. So our major goal when teaching becomes to minimize distractors and to help your working memory to easily identify important information and encode it into long-term memory storage. Our weapon of choice for uploading visual information into your brains is PowerPoint, or Keynote, or Google Slides, whichever you prefer. The problem is that slides are a low-resolution medium. Look at how much information fits on a page of this article on cerebral edema in intracranial pressure management. If you paste this information on a slide, it will be unreadable. To maximize learning, you need to boil down the information to the most important points, but you're still not done. You then need to translate that information to PowerPoint by designing and visualizing the data. After all, PowerPoint is a visual medium. And speaking of design, design is not decoration. Think of a cake. A cake tastes the same whether or not it's decorated. Design is about choosing the right tools to illustrate your ideas, your fonts, colors, images, and layout. When teaching, design works for you. Decoration always works against you because it increases the cognitive load. So stop decorating your over here. You're staring at the hummingbird, aren't you? Gotcha. This just proves my point about the distractibility of unnecessary color and movement. And this hummingbird was dangerously easy to make in PowerPoint. Alright, let's see how this works in practice. Let's say I'm trying to teach you about the classification of seizure types. This text is taken directly from the International League Against Epilepsy's 2017 Epilepsy Classification. I can just feel you trying to read this while listening to me. The dense text is bad, yes, but even worse, what I'm saying does not match what's written on the slide. The cognitive load must be immense. Let's try to do something about it. This paper also had a table, which now replaced the text. The speaker also added images in hopes of illustrating the seizure types. Is this clearer? Well, it's better than the dense text, but the visual organization could use some work. When looking at the slide, your eye may inadvertently go to the red Rutgers logo, then to the first image, then to the second image with its very exciting jagged red lines, then to the title with its largest font, then to the subtitle, the categories outlined in red, the next largest font, you get the idea. The speaker, me, is no longer controlling the learner's attention. So the slide is working against me and increases your cognitive load. Let's try to remove decorations and unnecessary distractions. That's better. But the slide is still too dense, and the images grab my attention more than the seizure types. Let's keep working at it. Now the images are not as exciting, and we're using the trick of chunking to cohort-related materials. Anything inside a chunk is essentially treated as related information, as one thing, by your working memory. You now have to pay attention to 5 design elements instead of over a dozen. That trick helps decrease your cognitive load. Let's try another example. Say I'm trying to teach students how to identify signs of acute stroke. By the way, how many students have actually seen a slide like this? How many students have actually presented a slide like this? Be honest. We've got fonts, we've got tables, we've got colors, highlights, and underlines. We've got an image of a clot-retrieving device. Everything is vying for attention. Everything is important. Which really means nothing is. Phase 1. Remove distractions. We're moving in the right direction, but the slide is still too dense. The central theme here is the National Institutes of Health Stroke Scale. It's a structured neurological examination that is designed to pick up significant deficits. Maybe I should just show the stroke scale. Getting warmer, but it's still a bunch of text on the slide. Remember that PowerPoint is a visual medium. How about this? Balance, eyes, face, arm, speech, and time. What does that spell? Be fast. These are the important factors in recognizing a stroke.
It is a quick digital clip playing by the elevators at Robert Wood Johnson University Hospital in New Brunswick. But for 49-year-old Mark Chakowski, these warning signs of a stroke were a lifesaver.
You stand there every day waiting for an elevator and there's things to read, so I read it.
That's lucky for Chakowski, one of Walker's carpenters for the past 3 years. The father of three made a fateful call to his boss about 9 months ago.
You really couldn't understand what he was saying. Just, it made no sense whatsoever.
Walker immediately called Chagowski's wife.
He said, in no uncertain terms, get him to the hospital now, he's having a stroke.
It was crucial that he received medical care so quickly. Chakowski still has slurred speech at times, but is otherwise now doing well. He hopes to be back on the job soon, the same place as this life-saving sign.
So whether it's analyzing uncertainty for the crew of the Shuttle Columbia, or teaching stroke symptoms to help identify and treat a stroke victim, design matters. And I hope that the next time you use slides to teach, you will take the time to design. That's all for today. Until next time, thank you.